Welcome to the home of 100 to 1 Faith TV. I'm Larry Gent, and this is the message for Grace Heartwood United Methodist Church on November 15th, Investing with Jesus. Our psalm for the day is 136, verses 1 through 9. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, his love endures forever. Who by his understanding made the heavens, his love endures forever. Who spread out the earth upon the waters, his love endures forever. Who made the great lights, his love endures forever. The sun to govern the day, his love endures forever. The moon and stars to govern the night, his love endures forever. The epistle lesson is Titus 3, verses 1 through 7. Remind people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate, and to always be gentle toward everyone. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. And our gospel lesson is Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I've gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the one who had received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you're a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown, and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed? Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Peter and John went to pray.
This smiley-faced sponge is called Scrub Daddy. You may have seen it advertised on TV. It's the most successful product ever to come out of the Shark Tank. If you've never seen it, the Shark Tank is a reality TV show where folks pitch their ideas to investors. The investors put up cash to help get a company started. The pitch for Scrub Daddy must have been pretty good because it inspired somebody to put up nearly $250,000 to make sponges. It turned out to be a wise investment. Since then, Scrub Daddy has sold 10 million sponges for a total of $50 million. That's a 250% return on investment. Not a bad deal. Well, as far as I know, Jesus never appeared on Shark Tank, but he told a story about a ruler who invested in his servants. He trusted his servants to be his partners. Now, we don't know how the servants invested those funds. Maybe they bought a kitchen sponge factory, I don't know. But somehow, two of those servants decided to take a risk, and both of them saw their money doubled. Okay, that's nothing like the success of the Scrub Daddy, but 100% return on investment is pretty good in anybody's book. But one of the servants didn't want to take any risks. He decided to play it safe. He dug a hole and hid the cash. He took zero risks, but he got zero in return. He didn't attempt to become a partner in the kingdom. Maybe he had some great ideas, but he was just scared to try. He played it safe so he could give back the gift he received. Now, let me pause right here to say this is a sermon I heard a lot as a kid growing up in church. The story of the talents comes up every year at Thanksgiving season, and it provides a pretty handy stick to lay down a load of guilt. The sermon went something like this. At this time of year, we give thanks for God's many blessings. But what have you done with the blessings you have received? Have you invested them wisely in the kingdom of God? Or have you kept your talents hidden? What have you done with your talents? Have you really given enough to God? It's one of those sermons that leaves you feeling more guilty when you finish church than when you started. Now, I have to admit, guilt can be a powerful motivator. Sometimes moms understand this. Do you know how many moms it takes to change a light bulb? Oh, none. I know you're busy. I'll just sit here in the dark. Yeah, moms and preachers understand that guilt can be a better motivator than grace. But there's a problem with that sermon. It makes the return of the king out to be a threat. Bad news, big trouble. Here comes Jesus, and boy, is he mad. That's exactly what the third servant thought. He thought his Lord was mean-spirited and hard-hearted. He tried to hide from his Lord's return and was too scared to take a risk. And here's the thing. he got exactly the kind of Lord he was expecting. But the other two saw their Lord as someone who loved them and valued them, someone who invested in them and their dreams and visions. And we're not talking small investments. We're talking big, bulging bags of cash. They were both looking forward to their Lord's return because they trusted their Lord as much as he trusted them. They believed their master was kind and generous. They saw abundance, and they got more abundance. But the one who saw harsh judgment got harsh judgment. In that day and time, it wasn't uncommon for a lord to put stewards in charge of his estate while he was away. In this story, Jesus is telling us that we're his stewards, in charge of building his estate until he returns. Here's where the metaphor breaks down. Last time I checked, Jesus wasn't handing out bags of cash. He isn't trying to tell us that the rich should get richer and the poor should get poorer. He's trying to convince us to jump into the shark tank. He wants us to risk investing in the kingdom of God. Yes, there are plenty of examples where Jesus tells us that no one is completely saved until the checkbook is baptized along with the soul. But following Jesus is not a get-rich-quick scheme. So what kind of capital does Jesus hand out for investment? You already know the answer. Love, mercy, kindness, grace. Those are all high-risk investments, aren't they? And they aren't invitations to invest in sponges. Jesus wants us to invest in people. He took the biggest risk of all. He invested his blood on the cross while we were yet sinners. And if your heart and soul were the only return he ever got on that investment, he would have considered it all worthwhile. But let me confess something here. I'm running a little bit low on that investment stock this year. It's been a strange year, a divisive year, a difficult year. When things went wrong, we used to say, "That's Murphy's Law." Now all we have to say is, "Must be 2020. No further explanation necessary. I'm running low on patience. I've just about run out of grace. My stock of kindness and compassion ran out way before the election. And I find it pretty easy here lately for people to get on my very last good nerve, and I'm pretty sure they're trying to do it. Maybe that's why Jesus didn't ask us to invest our own capital in the people around us. He left us with big, bulging bags, not stuffed with silver or gold or folding money, but overflowing with love and mercy. He left us in charge of building his kingdom, and he left us with the gifts we need to do it. Grace may be the only place left where people, black and white, yellow and red and brown, can invest in each other. It might be the only place left where Democrats and Republicans, liberals and conservatives can value each other more than their own opinions. Facebook, Twitter, talk radio, TV news feeds, internet rumor mills, they've all been a steady stream of live ordnance fired straight up into the air. And you know how many hearts and minds those missiles have managed to change? Absolutely none. But you have the investment capital necessary to change your community, to change your nation, to change the world. Kindness, compassion, and mercy, those are the things that do change hearts and minds. When you invest that capital in people who have not, who cannot earn it, we call it grace. Amazing grace. It's a high-risk investment strategy, especially this year. But Jesus thinks you're worth it. Don't let 2020 keep it hidden. Believe in God's abundance, and you'll receive more abundance. Invest it until you see 100% return. Invest it like there's no tomorrow. Invest it because you never know when the Lord will return. Invest it because that's the only return that really matters.
Peter and John went to pray.